Or vote. We are thankful for this privilege to preach to you tonight. And Brother Larry called me Sunday, yesterday, I guess it was. I have been praying for Brother Ross and anticipating hearing him preach, but the Lord had a different plan for tonight. And I would ask you to keep a cousin of mine, first cousin, on my mother's side, Mike Myers. My niece called me today, and Mike had back surgery. She didn't say exactly how long ago, but he had come home from the back surgery, and his wife just dropped dead.
Oh, man.
And after the funeral, he felt something in his back, and he had a blood clot that had formed and burst, and he's in the hospital now. His name's Mike Myers. And so, and I can imagine, you know, the pain, so to speak, of losing your wife just unexpectedly, and then having this on top of it. And I think his children all live up there. But my sister lives in Florida. I had a birthday a week or so ago, and we were talking. And you know how things will come up in your mind. And I was thinking about those cousins on my mother's side. There was only 7 grandchildren on my mother's side, 4 of us, and then Uncle Bill had the 3. And since we've been growing, we've had very little contact with the Myers side, and we were talking about that. Mike was always going to have everybody get together, and just never got everything together. But I'm 69, and I'm in good health. But you know, I've had a lot of cousins right around my age that have already passed on, and we don't know
right
how much time we have on this earth. But what time we have, we need to use it.
That's right.
For His honor and His glory.
You're right.
And we've asked you to turn tonight to James chapter 4. Now, my wife said she wasn't going to take notes tonight. She thinks she's heard this already. But one time, when we were pastoring over in Eastern Kentucky, I was asked to preach a fellowship meeting up at Myrtle Tree Baptist Church. Brother Robert Asbury, I don't know if any of you ever knew him, he was pastor there at that time. And Aaron said, "Care if I bring my girlfriend with me tonight and we go up there?" I don't care. And Myrtle Tree was about 55 miles from where we lived. And he's joking around, being Aaron. And we got about 5 miles from Myrtle Tree Baptist Church. And he says, "By the way, Dad, who's preaching tonight?" "I am." He says, "You mean I come 50 miles just to hear something I've already heard?" Well, if it's worth hearing once, it's worth hearing twice. But in James chapter 4, beginning in verse 13, he says, "Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city, and continue there a year, and buy and sell, and get gain. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time, and then vanisheth away. For that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. But now ye rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil.
Amen.
Therefore, To him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin.
Amen.
And many times, and it can be applied in many different ways, verse 17. But I believe here, verse 17 is applying what we've just read. And the subject tonight will be in the form of a question. What will we do with tomorrow? Yeah. You know, many of all of us fall into this. We take for granted many times that tomorrow is going to come. We make plans, and there's nothing wrong with making plans and preparations. But at the same time, as we see in these verses here, our plans and preparations ought to be in conjunction with the fact that if the Lord will, if the Lord will. Back in the church voted to put it, to remodel a kitchen. And the guy came, I believe it was in July sometime, June or July, and measured everything in give us a price, and then he didn't give us an exact time when he was going to come. Well, we called from time to time, and it was delayed because his wife had been real ill, and she had been in Vanderbilt for a while. Well, they called us last week and said that they were going to come today and tear out all the old stuff, and he was going to come back on Wednesday and install the new cabinets. Well, I called this morning to see what time he was coming, and his secretary said, I'll call you back. He hasn't come in yet. Well, she called me back about, I think it was about 9 o'clock, and she said, he's here at work, but he's got the flu, and he won't be to your house until Wednesday. And she said, I don't know why he don't go home, but he says he'll feel as bad at home as he does here. But he didn't want to go into anybody's house and give them the flu. Well, you know, here we think, you know, Monday the guy's going to be here.
Right.
And I apply this to myself too. We didn't really say if the Lord wills.
Right.
He'll be here. So as we look back in verse 13, he says, here, go to now. Ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Now that is the mentality of most of us.
You're right.
And so what are we going to do with tomorrow? You know, there's an old saying, you probably all heard it, but there's an old saying when I was growing up, yesterday's gone and tomorrow never gets here. And that's true. You know, yesterday is history. And we don't know if tomorrow is going to get here. But if tomorrow gets here, it's today.
Yeah.
And today is history. Mm-hmm. But we are all guilty of thinking that we're going to continue in this world.
That's right.
Forever. Mm-hmm. You know, even though people may have some severe illnesses and it looks gray for them, they still don't want to face the fact that tomorrow may not get here. Mm-hmm. No one wants to die. Well, you know, in a sense, none of us do. But if we're saved by the grace of God, death shouldn't look that bad to us.
Right. Amen.
And the thing that we really get bogged down in is the separation from the world we know. Mm-hmm. But again, what are we going to do with tomorrow? We can't borrow from tomorrow, because tomorrow never gets here. Mm-hmm. Yet many times, as we see here in this verse, we are boasters of what we're going to do tomorrow. And most of the time, if you talk to anybody who is in the world and a subject like this, they'll look at you like you've got a few screws loose. Mm-hmm. Because they plan. And as far as they're concerned, you know it's going to take place. But we don't know what's going to take place tomorrow. Just like in a few weeks, I think it's what, 4 weeks from today, we have the election. We don't know what's going to happen. We can kind of guess, depending on who wins that election, what's going to take place. None of it looks real good. But yet, people are planning and plotting on what they're going to do. But they don't know the election's even going to take place.
You're right.
You know, as we look upon the time we have on this earth, and we think about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, our focus really should be on the return of the Lord Jesus Christ.
You're right.
More
Amen.
Than what we're going to do tomorrow.
Yeah.
Too much of our time, we don't give the Lord any consideration when we plan for another day.
Mm-hmm.
And we are too presumptuous of tomorrow. Look back in Isaiah chapter 56 and verse 12 for a moment. Isaiah chapter 56. And verse 12. Isaiah 56 and verse 12 says, "Come ye, say they, I will fetch wine, and we will fill ourselves with strong drink. And tomorrow shall be as this day, and much more abundant." We don't know that.
You're right.
It's like my cousin that I mentioned. And I don't know, they didn't tell me when he had back surgery, but say a couple weeks ago when he had that back surgery, he anticipated on coming home to his wife, and he got home and she dropped dead, mm-hmm. unexpectedly. How old she was, he's 61, and so I know she's probably in that range. But there's no guarantees of tomorrow.
You're right.
And the sad part about them was, their cat.
Mm-hmm.
And a former brother-in-law, who's deceased now, a brother-in-law of mine, tried to witness to them on several occasions. And they very rudely told him that she said, "I'm Catholic and I don't need anything. I've got all I need." She probably knows different now.
You're right.
But we don't know. When we are presumptuous of tomorrow and our plan for tomorrow, are we not tempting the Lord?
Yep.
Are we not tempting Him with our own sins? And I believe as we get down to verse 17, that's what He's telling us here. You know, when we presume that we're going to have another day, or that if another day comes, we're going to do exactly this. How many times have we gotten up of a morning and we have had plans for the day, but the phone rings and there's something that takes precedence over what we had planned?
Mm-hmm.
Again, if the Lord willing, as we shall see here, the Lord wills, we're going to do this or that. Again, in verse 14, he says, "Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away." Now, when you think about that for a moment, you know, we think of, you know, life is a vapor. But when you consider, take whatever age you are, and you compare that to approximately 6,000 years of this earth has been in existence.
Right.
What is our life compared to that? It's but a vapor.
Mm-hmm.
There's other scriptures that he gives us where he likens us unto the grass. You know, we're at the end of our grass season. I enjoy cutting grass, But yet, it, when it comes at the end of the summer, I'm kind of glad when I don't have to cut it anymore for a while. But what about that grass? And it's not like it was here. When I grew up, where I grew up in Michigan, I mean, when it got winter time up there, if you had brown, just brown stuff out there in the yard, because the frost and everything killed everything. Around here sometimes we'll have green grass through the winter times. But where our life is like a vapor. And you see, and you like a vapor. And what is a vapor? When they had the old drip coffee pots, you'd heat the water in the tea kettle and you pour it in the top. Okay, when that tea kettle would start to boil, that vapor would come out.
Mm-hmm.
And it would just vanish in the air. That's what our life is.
Right.
That's what our life is. And we don't know that the Lord's going to give us a tomorrow. Only the Lord knows what will take place tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that? Because He has decreed all that's going to come to pass. That's one reason why we need to seek His will and say, if the Lord wills, we'll do this and we'll do that. In Ecclesiastes in chapter 9, Ecclesiastes chapter 9 and verse number 12, we find here, he says, for man also knoweth not his time, as the fishes that are taken in an evil net, and as the birds that are caught in the snare, so are the sons of man snared in an evil time when it falleth suddenly upon them. Life is not forever.
Amen.
We may have tomorrow, and we desire to have a tomorrow, but we need to desire that in the Lord's will. Not presumptuously say we're going to have tomorrow and presume that we're going to be in your case here tomorrow night in the house of the Lord. And I know you desire to, and I hope that Brother Ross is here and is able to preach to you. But as the Lord wills.
Right.
As the Lord wills. Each day the Lord gives us shall be a time to seek His guidance. You know, we're all made of the same flesh.
Mm-hmm.
And there's been too many times that I've gotten up in the morning and I walk, get my walk, but we allow things in this world to distract us, and it can get us all off course. Good intentions are only as good as they're followed through on.
Mm-hmm.
How many people everybody's got good intentions. And yet again, as we said, we can allow things to distract us. And what I've found in my own personal life, when I go to my study and I've got that computer sitting there, best thing to do is not even turn it on.
Mm-hmm.
Until I've prayed and studied the Word of God and I've sat there, not just study it, but sit there and meditate upon what you've read and studied.
Amen.
But if you turn that
computer
on, you know you can waste more time.
You're right. Amen.
Than anything else. Mm-hmm. And what has that day given us? Because what I found myself, if you've gotten involved looking at things in that computer, it messes up your thinking when you're studying the Word of God.
Amen.
Because time after time after time, when you allow something to distract you and you're reading and studying, those things keep coming back to your mind.
Uh-huh.
What are we going to do with tomorrow? What are we going to do? In one of those passages in 1 Peter chapter 1 is reflecting here of the shortness of our life again. In verses 24 and 25, he says, "For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. And the word of the Lord endureth forever."
Amen.
"And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you." What there's two things that he's emphasizing here as far as what we can do with tomorrow. You know, life is short and fast and fades away.
Mm-hmm.
But the Lord endureth forever. When I pass from this world, I'm going to be in His presence forever. And that is the day, that is tomorrow, the tomorrow that we should be looking for. And that is the day that we should be really planning for. And as we plan, we see here that Peter speaks of the gospel. I just recently finished reading a book that was entitled Things That We Need to Know About Islam. And it's alarming what they believe.
Right.
And you know, the only thing that's going to help them is the gospel.
Amen.
And reading through that and seeing, you know, that thinking that their thoughts that Muhammad was actually a prophet of God and received the last revelation, this is so false.
Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ, as He closed out the book of Revelation, made it plain that this is the revelation, I'm talking about from Genesis through Revelation, that God has given us.
Amen.
And we don't need anything else. But that is what we need to preach today. That there be guaranteed a tomorrow. Not a tomorrow, necessarily not a tomorrow in this world, but a tomorrow. And that's the tomorrow we need to be planning for. The tomorrow of eternal life. The things of this world will all pass away. Time comes and goes for each of us here. Yet eternity is forever.
Amen.
You know, I like history. I like reading about history. And yet it's the future of the Lord that counts. We can learn a lot from history, but yet we can learn more from this book. It is the Lord's, if it's the Lord's will, we will see another day upon this earth. As He says here in verse 15, He says, "For ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that." And I like when, as I read through the scriptures, and when it is speaking of things concerning the Lord, when he says it shall come to pass. It shall be. And what he's saying here says, "For ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live." He's talking about upon this earth. And do this or do that. If the Lord wills, we shall rise up in the morning. If the Lord wills, you shall have services here tomorrow night.
Right.
If the Lord wills, the cabinet man shall come and tear out our old stuff on Wednesday and come out back on Friday, if the Lord wills.
That's it.
And put in that new those new cabinets. If the Lord wills, notice he says, "For that ye ought to say."
Mm-hmm.
For ye ought to say. And this is what we need to say about tomorrow. If the Lord wills, we'll have tomorrow. If the Lord wills, our plans will be carried out for tomorrow. But you know what we should do first of all with our plans for tomorrow? Seek the Lord's will first.
Right.
Seek the Lord's will first. How many times do we actually do that? How many times do we actually sit down and say, well, on Tuesday, October 11th, Lord, I want to do this, if it's your will. I doubt any of us do that.
You're right.
But this is what he's telling us here. What are we going to do with tomorrow? And the book of Psalms 78, Psalm 78, and verses 38 and 39, we find here, Psalm says, but he, being full of compassion, forgiveth their iniquities, and destroyed them not. Yea, many a time turned he his anger away, and did not stir up all his wrath. For he remembered that they were but flesh, and wind that passeth away, and cometh not again. He's talking about how the Lord views us.
Amen.
And as we study through the Old Testament, especially when you get into the prophets, Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Isaiah, and you see where God continuously over and over and over again warned them that if you don't repent, if you don't repent, I'm going to send you into captivity.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And we've been studying Ezekiel in Sunday school. And the Lord, when he come to Ezekiel, he says, go speak to my people.
Yeah.
He says, they didn't listen to me, and they're not going to listen to you. But go speak to my people.
Right.
And you know what? Many times, we're just like Israel. God speaks to us continuously, but we don't hear him. We don't hear him. And when we give thought sometimes, at times, to these words in James, and we'll stop and we'll pray and we'll seek God's will and ask for God's will for if he gives us it tomorrow. But you know, many times within a short time, that lesson has left us. Why? Because as we've seen there in Psalms, we're flesh.
Mm-hmm.
We're flesh. We're of the same mold as Adam. And when Adam fell in the Garden of Eden, and you can look at us, and this is what he got.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you just go through Genesis chapter 3, and you see Adam and Eve, when they took of the forbidden fruit, and God approached them, and they hid themselves because they were naked. And God asked them, Adam, did you eat that which I told you not to? Well, what was his response? The woman that you gave.
Right.
And then when he confronted Eve, she said, well, you know, the serpent beguiled me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is all true. Well, what did that do? You know, we may not be like Adam, and we know that we haven't ate of that tree that he ate up, or he ate Eve. But we have the same nature.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Same nature. And we look at tomorrow, and as though it's a guarantee, but nothing's guaranteed in this life. What are we going to do tomorrow? If the Lord wills, we will fulfill our plans for tomorrow. You know, looking back at Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 3. Hebrews chapter 6 in verse 3. The Bible tells us here, and this will we do if God permit.
Right.
This will we do if God permit. And, you know, when the Lord came to Moses on the backside of the desert and told him to go to his people because he was going to send him down there to deliver them from the bondage of Egypt. And we know the arguments that Moses gave, you know, I'm slow of speech and so on and so forth. And God sent, give him Aaron to help him. But as time progressed, and Moses stood up to Pharaoh, and then commanded Israel, and we know as the plagues went through, and that final plague, the death of the firstborn, and the victory that they had that night, and as they went and crossed, got to the red edge of the Red Sea, the people began to murmur.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they forgot what happened yesterday. And many times when we plan for tomorrow, we forget what happened yesterday. God was in control of yesterday. God is in control of today. And God is in control of tomorrow.
Amen.
And as God opened up the Red Sea, and they crossed the Red Sea on dry ground, and as Pharaoh's army converged on them, and God brought in that Red Sea and drowned the army of the Egyptians, again, it was just a short time when Israel began to murmur and complain.
You're right.
Why? Because they forgot what just happened. That's part of our problem. When we say, tomorrow we're going to do this or do that, and fail to confront the Lord. He took care of today. And if tomorrow comes, He's going to take care of tomorrow. And we think of just this past week when this humongous hurricane hugged the coast of Florida, Georgia, North and South Carolina, and I haven't heard the latest on how many died in it, but there was over, they estimate over 500 in Haiti.
Yeah.
And there's not been a storm like this, and I think, I forget how many years they said, it's been like 50 years since we've had a storm of this magnitude. And who was in control?
Amen.
And I believe many of the things that we're seeing take place in our world today, and I'm just not talking about our little piece of the globe, I'm talking about worldwide, this is God's judgment coming upon this world.
You're right.
He tells us that in the latter days, and I believe we're there, that in the latter days we're not talking about the end of the world. We're talking about leading up to the time of the resurrection and the rapture. There would be diseases and earthquakes and so forth in diverse places.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? It means where they're not normally. And we've heard of that. But in all of that, how many of those people that have been devastated by these, by the hand of the Lord, put it that way.
You're right.
How many of those people had plans for tomorrow? And they were hit with this devastation. Now, with the meteorologists we have today, people had plenty of warning that this storm was going to go along the coast. And they said they've never seen a hurricane before that hovered along the coast. Usually they will hit a landmass and die out. But this thing was over 700 miles wide. That's the power of God.
Amen.
And God purposed it. God planned it. How many people along the coast of the United States there are cursing God at this time? I don't know. I'm sure there are some.
Mm-hmm.
But again, what will they do with tomorrow now? Will they call upon the name of the Lord? Will they desire His leadership? And I know there's a couple of churches down there on the east coast of Florida, and I'm kind of interested to find out what kind of problems they had. Brother, some of you may not know Brother Seth Bourne. You know Brother Seth Bourne? He pastors there in Millbourne. And Brother Humphreys, David Humphreys, he pastors along there also on that east coast. So I'm kind of interested to find out what they had, and if there's anything you can do to help them.
Mm-hmm.
But what will they do with tomorrow?
Mm-hmm.
Verse 16 here, he says, "But now ye rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil." In other words, the plans of man. And I don't know if I can remember the exact quote now, but the best laid plans of mice and men, they used to say. And that's kind of what he's saying here. The best laid plans of mice and men. "Now ye rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil." In other words, when we boast, and boasting isn't necessarily where you're going to go out on the street corner and yell, "I'm going to do this tomorrow." But our boastings many times is within ourselves. We'll boast to ourselves, "I'm going to do this tomorrow. I've got this plan for tomorrow." How many times have you talked to somebody and asked them if on a certain date that, "Would you like to get together and do this?"
Right.
And they say, "No, I got other plans." Well, it's good to have plans. It's good to have outline of what you're going to do. But are we considering the Lord in our plans? Have we purposed the Lord in our plans? And also, you know, when we think about that, whenever you're going to head down the road, do you ever stop and ask for God's grace
mm-hmm.
and guidance as you travel? I usually do, but there's times I don't. You know what I notice sometimes when I don't? That's when some of those people that you might call idiots or something get in your way. So it is... pays, so to speak, to plan tomorrow and even the rest of the day with the Lord.
Amen.
Seek His face. Seek His guidance. We too often are joyful in our plans. Too often we plan for tomorrow with joy. You know, we're going to do this. And many times, you know, the twins today, Nathan and Noah's birthdays, and they're having a birthday party on Saturday, and we're planning to go to that. And, you know, too many times we can get saying, "Well, I'm going to that birthday party," you know, without giving any thought
right.
of the Lord carrying us there. You know, what used to bother me a lot, and I don't see it so much anymore. You see these little license plates on the front of people's cars saying, "God's my co-pilot." I don't want him as my co-pilot.
Right.
I want him as my pilot.
That's right.
Because I'm not in charge.
Amen.
We're not in charge of tomorrow. We're not in charge of our plans. He says, "But ye rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil." Look back here in chapter 3 and verse 5 of the book of James for a moment. He says, "Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth.
Right.
It's likening the tongue to a fire. And, you know, I've had many experiences in my lifetime I spent 3 years in the United States Army. And I've probably seen more boasters there than I have anywhere else in my life. And they were going to do this and they were going to do that. And when you don't plan on anything when you're in the military, because Uncle Sam's got your time. There was one time I met some people, because my uncle had a brother-in-law who was stationed in Carver, and we were planning I was going to go down there, and I did on a few occasions. But we were going to go down there, and they were going to have a ham operator to call back here to the States, and we were going to talk to all the relatives back here. And lo and behold, the Russians invaded Czechoslovakia, and everybody's passes and everything was canceled.
Right.
But here we were boasting about, we're going to meet on such a date, and we're going to call back to the States, and we're going to communicate with everybody. No, you're not.
Right. Amen.
No, you're not. And who planned that? Who purposed all this? The Lord did.
Amen.
Many of these things, I believe He's planned and purposed so that we don't get too boastful in our own doings. We need to stop and think about our tomorrow. That if tomorrow comes, what would the Lord have me to do?
Mm-hmm.
How would the Lord have me spend my time? Now, we've got planned tomorrow. Preachers usually meet once a month on a Tuesday morning for breakfast. We've got that planned tomorrow, Lord willing.
Right.
Lord willing. And Brother Larry's going to be able to make it this time, Lord willing.
Right.
Because there's been times that one or two of the preachers, when they got up that Tuesday morning, something came up.
Mm-hmm.
And they couldn't go. There's been times, like last week, that we just totally canceled out. Why? Because we have to depend upon the Lord. It's His time. He's not going to find the time.
Amen.
But it's His time. He put this world on a timetable. In verse 17, as we reflect back on these previous four verses, He says, therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. So as we apply these verses, you know, there's no guarantee of tomorrow. And if tomorrow comes, we need to plan and purpose and prepare what the Lord wills. And as I said, there's nothing wrong with having a plan, having a purpose, having something ironed out that you're going to do tomorrow. But again, if the Lord wills,
right,
do that.
Yeah.
If the Lord wills. You know, there's, I think something that's worse than not having any, than making plans, is not having any plans at all. You know people like that?
Mm-hmm.
There's too many in this nation. They've got nothing to do. They don't plan on doing anything except mischief. And that's one reason why we're in the mess we're in. But we need to think what we're going to do with tomorrow. And plan it, seek the Lord's will, and if the Lord wills, we will do thus and such. And He says, therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not. And we, if we read these scriptures, we know how the word is planned, if there is a tomorrow. But if we don't, what's he say? It's sin unto us. It's sin unto us. To him it is sin. There's a lot of things, and we think about sin. You know, too many people categorize sin as, you know, it's always something bad.
Right.
And when we look at us as children of God, we sin more than what we don't do.
You're right.
Than what we do do.
You're right.
And, you know, people that try to, and I've heard these terms through the years, sins of omission and sins of commission. Well, we understand what sins of omission are, things that we should do that we don't do. Sins of commission, you know, it's mostly the bad things. But you know, many things that people call the sins of omission are really sins of commission. Because you purpose not to do them.
Right.
And when we purpose not to plan our day according to the Lord's will, that's a sin of commission. That's a sin of commission. And if you don't know the scriptures, it would be a sin of ignorance. And the Lord covers that. You know, to he who much is given, much is required. On the other hand, if you haven't learned that, it's still sin. But the penalty is not as severe. And that's all in the Lord's hands. That's not my decision. That's not my category. The thing that we want to understand here tonight is, what are we going to do with tomorrow?
Mm-hmm.
What are we going to do with tomorrow? When we retire tonight, before we pull our feet up into that bed, will we ask, Lord, be thy will, give me a good night's sleep. Raise me up in the morning, seeking your will.
Amen.
This is what I pray at night. I pray for a good night's sleep, and that when I rise up in the morning, that I will seek the Lord's will for that day. And that's, you know, I heard, brother, I don't know if any of you ever knew H.H. Overby. We had classes, but he was talking about some man one time, some famous preacher, and I don't remember the name now, who was supposed to have been famous for his ability to pray. And they were somewhere, and Brother Overby was with him, and Brother Overby was set and was kneeled down beside the bed and was started praying. And he says, this preacher just rolled over in bed and said, good night, God. And when Brother Overby finished praying, he says, why'd you do that? He says, because I'm prayed up for the day. You know, I don't buy that. I don't care how much you pray during the day. But when you retire at night, you need to give thanks.
Amen.
For what the Lord has given us.
Yes, yes.
Through that day. And if he raises us up in the morning to another day, ask his guidance. Ask for his will to be done. You know, when we think about Matthew chapter 6 and what the world calls the Lord's Prayer, we know that is a model.
Right.
That is an outline. And what does he say? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. How many times do we pray and we neglect to address our Heavenly Father and hallowed be thy name? Thy will be done. Thy will be done. You know, this is his kingdom. This is his world.
Amen.
On earth as it is in heaven. And also he tells us within that, he says, that we would forgive those who have trespassed against us. You know, I've known a lot of people in my life, and some even today, that something has taken place, and to this day, they have not forgiven the individual that has committed the offense. And in some cases, the ones that they accuse of committing the offense don't even know that they've done anything wrong. Had that within my two older sisters. My older sister was, and there was a lot in our family like this that would hold grudges for years. And my oldest sister held a grudge against my next sister for years and years. And Vicki, the one that lives in Florida, she says, I just don't know why Marilyn is holding this grudge. I don't know what it's for. And she was up there visiting one time, and she says, Marilyn, I want to get this straight. I want this to be over. She says, there's no need in us having a grudge. And she says, if I have to, I'll get down on my hands and knees and beg you. Come find out, you know what the problem was? When Vicki was in seventh grade and Marilyn was in eighth grade, Vicki used Marilyn's makeup without asking her. So she held a grudge for all those years. Isn't that foolishness? But this is what we see happens when we're not in the Lord's will. Those old sins will come in.
Yep.
And again, you can apply this verse to many of those things. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. And you can apply that in many things in the scripture. But especially we need to apply it here. What will we do with tomorrow? What will we do with tomorrow?